Okay, that looms great. Yes. Oh, you won't hear me.
No. Well, yes. And y'all.
Good morning.
Good morning.
We're glad you're here, congregant or visitor. I'm Susan Andrew, and I'm here to say some of my favorite words. Whoever you are, wherever you come from, whomever you love, wherever you are on your journey, however you identify, you are welcome in our faith community. It's great to see everyone here, those of you in the sanctuary, and we're glad to have a way for those who can't be here in person to join us online. We're grateful for the presence of our music director, Les Downs, and our guest soloist, Tabitha Judy, and our amazing tech master, Simon Jacobs. Today we'll welcome Sean Gibson, fellow congregant, member of the Ministerial Search Committee and the Meadville-Lombard Theological Seminary, as our guest speaker as we focus our reflections on the topic of change. Now let us prepare for worship with today's centering music.
Coming, see the lightning part the skies. It's too late to run, there's terror in your eyes. What you do then is remember this old thing you heard me say. It's the storm, not you, that's bound to blow away. Feel that evil's at your door. There's no place to hide. You're frozen to the floor. What you do then is you force yourself to wake up and you say, it's this dream, not me, that's bound to go away. Just come flying at you from across the room. When you see a person raging and they're jealous and they fear that you've walked through walls they've hid behind for years, what you do then is you tell yourself to wait it out. You say, it's this day.
Thank you so much. That's intimidating to follow. Good morning, everyone. My name's Sean Gibson. I use he, him pronouns, and I am today's worship leader. Our chalice lighting this morning is words from Julian Lepp, Open to Unexpected Answers. We seek our place in the world and the answers to our heart's deep questions. as we seek, may our hearts be open to unexpected answers. And may the light of our chalice remind us that this is a community of warmth, of wisdom, and welcoming of multiple truths. I invite you to rise in body or spirit as we sing our first hymn, hymn number 188, Come, Come, Whoever You Are. Wisdom story? Are you? All right. Have you ever heard this one? Do you know this book? You do? You know this one? Can we tell, maybe we'll tell it together. Our wisdom story this morning is Iggy Peck, Architect by Andrea Beatty, illustrated by David Roberts. So I'll have the book here, but y'all can look up there too if it's not close enough. Young Iggy Peck is an architect and has been since he was 2. When he built a great tower in only an hour with nothing but diapers and glue. Good gracious, Ignatius, his mother exclaimed. That's the coolest thing I've ever seen. But her smile faded fast as a light wind blew past, and she realized those diapers weren't clean. Ignatius, my son, what on earth have you done? That's disgusting and nasty, it stinks. But Iggy was gone. He was out on the lawn, using dirt clods to build his great sphinx. When Iggy was 3, his parents could see his unusual passion would stay. He built churches and chapels from peaches and apples and temples from modeling clay. At dinner one night, to his father's delight, Iggy got a bright gleam in his eye and put on the porch, built the St. Louis Arch from pancakes and coconut pie. Dear Ig had made it until 2nd grade when his teacher was Miss Lila Greer. On the very first day, she had this to say, "We do not talk of buildings in here. Gothic or Romanesque, I couldn't care less about buildings ancient or new." She said in her lecture about architecture that it had no place in grade 2. Now that might seem severe, but she was sincere. For when she was no more than 7, she had a great fright at a dizzying height in a building so tall it scraped heaven. On an architect's tour of the 95th floor, young Lila got lost from the group. She was found 2 days later in a stuck elevator, eating cheese with a French circus troupe. So after that day, it's quite safe to say that she thought all building lovers were nuts. As a teacher, she taught that above all else, one ought to avoid them, no ifs, ands, or buts. But as you might guess, it would cause Iggy stress to hear such terrible talk. But he didn't hear. He sat in the rear, while building a castle of chalk. You, Iggy Peck, your desk is a wreck. Tear down that castle right now. You will not build in here. Is that perfectly clear? Do you need to see Principal Howe? No, I don't think so either. No, ma'am, Iggy said. He lowered his head. With no chance to build, his interest was killed. Now 2nd grade was a bore. After 12 long days that passed in a haze of reading, writing, and arithmetic,
Miss Greer took the class to Blue River Pass for a hike and an old-fashioned picnic. They crossed an old trestle to a small island nestled in the heart of a burbling stream, but they no sooner passed than the footbridge collapsed and Miss Lila Greer started to scream. "We're trapped here, oh my, alas, kids, goodbye." Her eyeballs rolled back in her head. She dropped to the ground with a vague groaning sound. Luckily fainted, not dead. The class was amazed. They stood there quite dazed, uncertain of what they should do. But one bright young man was off hatching a plan, which started with Miss Lila's shoe. Soon each lad and lass there at Blue River Pass was working together as one. And when she came to, Miss Lila Greer knew that something quite brave had been done. She looked in the air and saw hanging there a structure with cables and braces. And on the far side, beaming with pride, were 17 smiling young faces. Boots, tree roots, and strings, fruit roll-ups and things, some of which one should not mention, were stretched ridge to ridge in a glorious bridge dangling from shoestring suspension. That one's hard to say. It all became clear to Miss Lila Greer as she crossed that bridge over the stream. There are worse things to do when you're in grade two than to spend your time building a dream. And now every week at Blue River Creek Elementary in second grade, all the school kids can hear, along with Miss Greer, how the world's great buildings were made. The weekly guest speaker in t-shirt and sneakers talks of buildings from Rome to Quebec. Of course, he's the guy who builds towers from pie, that brilliant young man, Iggy Peck. And now is the time when we will sing our kids off to their religious exploration. We invite you to religious exploration. You'll be sung out of the sanctuary and meet your group leaders in the foyer or Sandburg Hall and go to classes together. Look for the adults holding a sign with your grade to find your group. Parents, if you're new or visiting today, please escort your children to their class to meet the group leader and find out where to pick up your child after worship. Let's sing them out.
As you go, may joy surround you.
Now in the center of our service and in the center of our lives, let us pause to honor the silences of the world. Let us open our hearts to the silent prayer for the healing of pain and that place of quiet and the soft, gentle coming of love. Let us share a moment of silence. Now we are at the time for acknowledging our joys and sorrows with a candle lighting ritual. If you're in the sanctuary, please feel free to come forward to light a candle. And if you're online, please write in the chat box any joys or sorrows that you would like to share with this congregation.
Before you say,
I'm here this morning representing Enough. This is a bit of a change for me. I'm too often heading into life in a mindset of perfectionism, which is sometimes a setup for coming up short. Enough is so vast a sweetness, Emily Dickinson wrote at age 19 in a love letter to Susan Gilbert, the person who became her first love and remained her muse, her mentor, her primary reader and editor, her fiercest lifelong attachment. In his wonderful short poem about the secret of happiness, Kurt Vonnegut exposed the taproot of our modern suffering as the gnawing sense that what we have is not enough, that what we are is not enough. This is our modern curse. A century of conspicuous consumption has trained us to be dutiful citizens of the Republic of Not Enough, swearing allegiance to a marketable myth of scarcity, hoarding toilet paper for the apocalypse. Along the way, we've unlearned how to live wide-eyed with wonder at what Herman Hesse called the little joys, those unpurchasable, unstorable emblems of aliveness that abound the moment we look up from our ledger of lack. May you discover some unpurchasable marker of aliveness in your world this week.
Good morning, UUC Asheville. Okay. Look, I'm really glad that I got to just look at you all and be present, and that makes me feel so comfortable. Thank you. So my name is Sean Gibson. I use he, him pronouns. I'm a member of this congregation, as well as an aspirant to Unitarian Universalist ministry, and I'm currently studying at Meadville Lombard Theological School in Chicago, Illinois. When I was asked to preach a sermon by our interim minister, Reverend Kathy Harrington, at first I was a little stunned, perhaps even shaken up a little bit. I've never preached a sermon before. And then that's when I remembered, oh yeah, that's what I'm in graduate school for. That means I have to preach. So, as a young seminarian who has read just enough to be dangerous and who has yet to take the course on preaching, I would love to start by asking for your grace and your patience. I'm still not sure whether I've written a sermon, a theological reflection, a testimony, a homily, or simply a talk. Regardless, I am grateful for your presence, and it's good to be together today. And I promise to do my very best to have you out by lunchtime.
We love you, Sean.
Thank you. Oh, my God. As a congregation, we are standing on the threshold of change. We have found and called our new lead minister, the Reverend Dr. Aldette Fulbright Fulson, and we have affirmed our commitment to do the work of dismantling systems of oppression within ourselves and our congregation, and in the larger faith tradition when we adopted the eighth principle. Now, as a religion, Unitarian Universalism is also standing at a threshold of institutional and theological change. At this year's General Assembly, delegates voted to continue the conversation about the proposed changes to the Article II bylaws that contain the well-known and well-loved eight principles, as well as the sources of Unitarian Universalism. A final vote will be held in 2024 to determine whether the Article II bylaws will officially change. There has not been a change to the Article II bylaws of the Unitarian Universalist Association's Constitution since 1995, when the sixth tradition, acknowledging the wisdom of earth-based traditions, was added. The principles and sources as they are now did not exist until 1985. and the original purposes and objectives of the newly formed UUA were created in 1959 and spoke only about those things that united the two merging traditions. This is what we mean when we say that Unitarian Universalism is a living tradition. We are open to new wisdom and new insights as they reveal themselves to us throughout time. As someone newer to the Unitarian Universalist faith, I know I have so much catching up to do to better understand our shared history, our shared stories, and our impact in the areas of social change. This was my first year attending a General Assembly, and I hope it's the first of many others. Because of the proposed changes to Article 2 and how it had the potential to shape this faith tradition, I naturally wanted to be there. And as I watched the general sessions that were largely dedicated to discussing the proposed amendments to the Article 2 study report, I saw a wonderful thing. Unitarian Universalists showing up with passion in their eyes and in their hearts for this, our shared faith tradition. Some were online, some were in person, but all were equally ready to engage in this most important work. Some brought new ideas to the proposed wording or asked for clarifying information. And it must be stated that some were saddened, shocked, and some obviously were hurt to think that the seven principles would no longer hold such a place in our faith tradition. As we've heard for a while now, the Article 2 Study Commission has proposed changing the purposes and objectives from our shared principles to a system of shared values. Values like generosity, equity, justice, pluralism, interdependence, not individualism. See, I'm about to get in trouble already. And transformation, which were all fundamentally grounded in radical love. Seven guiding values rather than eight guiding principles. And now, as a Unitarian Universalist, a large part of what I came to identify with were the seven principles, as many of us do. Affirming the inherent worth and dignity of every person. Engaging in the democratic process, and encouraging the search for spiritual truth and meaning with liberty and justice for all. I could get behind that. Even if I didn't have a full idea or understanding about which truth I was encouraged to find, or what the work of justice was, or even what the word inherent meant, I was still given a set of statements that gave me a general idea of what UUism was about that I could get behind. And in fact, I've heard some use this as a reason to not move forward in considering using open values like love, equity, or pluralism. What does pluralism mean? And won't that make some people uncomfortable? We, of course, at times want to do everything that we can to refrain from feeling or making others feel uncomfortable. We practice our elevator speeches so that when someone asks us what church we go to, we can quickly respond to the person's second question, which usually is, "What the heck is Unitarian Universalism?" Now, this isn't to knock a good elevator speech. Sometimes you need a quick way to communicate that we are a spiritual community of like-minded people of all faiths and those who don't identify with concepts like faith. Here's a hint, that's part of my elevator speech. Yet sometimes having that practiced response so quick at hand can take us right out of that conversation. Because then we might be trying to remember our favorite principle because we know they're going to ask us next, well, what do Unitarian Universalists believe? And frankly, I've really not always known what to say that Unitarian Universalism actually is. So I decided I couldn't stand it anymore and ran off to seminary. Now, that isn't to try and convince you all to go to seminary. But while we're on the subject, I am coming to learn some pretty interesting things. Edward Foley, in his work on theological reflection across religious traditions, speaks about how traditional theology has been a conversation dominated primarily by the Christian community, played on their playing field and using their theological language. Indeed, he himself used to teach a method of theological reflection that centered the Christian narrative as the central foundation from which to have conversation with all other faith traditions. It was his thought that by working from the Christian foundation and working outward in an adaptive, interpretive model, that the other faith traditions could reflect upon similar or near to similar beliefs across their cultural contexts, and that this would foster shared understanding. Now, Foley later came to see that this method of believing from the inside out, centered in the Christian experience, as limiting, presumptive, and that it promoted an attitude centered in colonialism. Foley came to find it better to use a method which seeks an outside-in approach to theological reflection that honors others' ways of communicating about life's deeper questions. The method of theological reflection, however, does not come without some risk. Participants should be willing to learn from another's perspective, and they should be comfortable with the idea of suspending their own deeply held beliefs in order to be open to learning from another's point of view. When there can be as many open roads into shared theological dialogue, this allows for a diversity of language and perspective in sharing our deeply held spiritual beliefs. Sometimes talking about life's deep questions does come with some pretty scary risks. For instance, we use currently affirm and promote the inherent worth and dignity of every person. It's our first principle. But imagine a future when we may not have our seven principles. Without that pre-formulated statement, when someone asks the third question, what do Unitarian Universalists believe, what will we say? Will our new values suffice? Will we simply say love, generosity, transformation? I mean, I'm not sure. Our old statements just seem to sum it up so beautifully. Where did the principles go? Some of us may wonder. I honestly hope that we can learn to simply just answer that we believe in love, justice, and respecting various points of view. That's what plurality means, by the way. Because what's sure to follow next will be new and deeper conversations. They may ask, what do you mean when you say you believe in love? Or how do you practice generosity? Tell me about transformation. Because have we ever honestly gotten into a deep conversation about what a free and responsible search for truth and meaning is all about when sharing our faiths with someone else? I mean, sometimes, maybe. Do we all search for truth and meaning in the same way or in the same place? I doubt it. So how do you do Unitarian Universalism? Angus MacLean, a Presbyterian-turned-Universalist minister born in 1892, gave a lecture before the Universalist Sabbath School Union of Greater Boston in 1962, where he claimed that the greatest method of relaying the shared values of Unitarian Universalism was not in any transmission of stated principles or doctrines. Indeed, UUs have prided themselves in remaining a non-dogmatic, non-creedal faith tradition, free from the bonds of doctrine. And yet we've come to reach first for our pre-rehearsed pickup lines, rather than engaging in risky conversations about love, justice, beauty, or wisdom. We have become unaccustomed to engaging in deep philosophical and theological conversations about life's deeper meanings. At times it even seems that we resist classifying ourselves as a religion at all, or that to use or hear theological or religious language in our sermons upsets our sensibilities. I, for one, will say that entering seminary and being bombarded by Christian language and theology was a bit surprising, especially considering I go to a Unitarian Universalist seminary. If you know our history, it shows what I know, right? But by remaining open to that process, and by being willing to sacrifice some comfort, I've come to see forms of Christianity outside of the fundamental, dogmatic, and nationalistic view that I was given as a child. I'm amazed to find that the things I value now may be more in line with more healthy versions of Christian belief than I formerly thought. As a young adult, I struggled to reconcile beliefs about my fundamentalist childhood with who I am as a person. I mean, when you're villainized by the very people who first taught you about God, it makes it hard to believe anything else. Some would wonder why I didn't do away with believing altogether. Instead, I became curious about other beliefs and found myself changed by being open to new ways of believing. Some of them did not include believing in any God at all. Some ways included seeing God as goddess or thinking of God as the ultimate playing field of all existence. Or experiencing God in the rain, the rivers, and the trees. Change can be scary, but it is in this threshold of change where we have the potential to see things from a new perspective. As a congregation, we have experienced significant change, especially since the beginning of the COVID pandemic. And yet we have made it through. We have adapted. We have become more comfortable with being uncomfortable. And now we're making even more changes. We're about to launch a new ministry. What else will we decide to change together? Will we make a new covenant? Will some committees change and fade while others are created? Will positions be switched? Roles changed, new members invited and welcomed into our community? Absolutely. It doesn't really matter where you choose to plug in. It only really matters that you do, and that you do so with an open heart. The most important message behind the talk given by Angus McLean at the Unitarian Universalist, the Universalist Sabbath School Union was that the lesson plan can be about whatever topic you'd like it to be. But the method used to convey that message was, in fact, the message itself. While people may remember what you taught them, they will remember with far more accuracy how you treated them. We do not learn what it means to be Unitarian Universalist from reciting creeds or principles, but by living out the values that we say are important to us. Together in community and in relationship with each other, we demonstrate those values when we teach our children and share our faith and center our values in all that we do. Not just on Sundays, or at least I hope, and I think other ministers do too, but throughout the week. What would it look like if we were to take this idea of covenant into our lives and act as if we were in covenant with the rest of humanity and the rest of life on this planet? That's interdependence, by the way. The proposed changes to Article 2, in my opinion, allow us to interact with the world through our values with much deeper conviction. And those values will allow us to explore what it means to be Unitarian Universalist. More important than any words or phrases or statements, our method of love is the message. May we be willing to step across the threshold of change together and imagine new ways of faithfully becoming. Maybe so.
I think we should sing a Holly Near song. What do you think? If you haven't seen the E! News, Holly Near and pianist John Bacchino will be here in concert on September the 8th at 7:30. And I'm hoping y'all will come, because I'm gonna tell Holly, I'm gonna be bold and tell Holly that we know some of her songs, so in case she wants to do a sing-along at her concert. So it's very appropriate, I think, that we sing I Am Willing. You have your music sheets, words will be on the screens. We're gonna let Tabitha start it off and sing the first refrain in the verse, and then I'll bring you in. Please rise in body or spirit.
The moment in our time together that we invite visitors to stand and introduce themselves. We have microphones that circulate to make it a little easier to project your voice. Would anyone like to let us know that you're here this morning?
Hi, I'm Diane Lombardi. I'm from Long Island, New York, and I belong to a UU congregation there.
Welcome.
Welcome. I'm Jean Anthony. This is my sister-in-law. She came to visit. I live in Hendersonville.
Welcome.
Now we'll get Good morning, everyone. I'm Buddy Kirby, and I'm visiting from Bluffton, South Carolina.
Welcome.
Hey, I'm Nicole Sakura Heshong. I'm here from Greenville, South Carolina, and this is my sister, and this was a halfway meeting point for us.
Oh, yes. Hi, I'm Emily Sakura Katz, and I live over the mountain in Johnson City and go to Woo. Unitarian Church. Woo, there. And she's my sister.
Welcome.
Hello, good morning, everyone. I'm from Pakistan, and I am here to do my PhD at UGA, and I'm thankful to James that he brought me here. Thank you,
Welcome.
Everybody.
Thank you.
I'm not new. I'm Nancy Bragg, and I'm a member of the Care Connect team. And I want to welcome all the visitors in Sandberg Hall. Afterwards, answer any questions you have. There's a table over there for new people.
Thank you, Nancy.
Well, thank you very much. Welcome to join us for coffee in Sandberg Hall after the service. We'd love to greet you in person and welcome you among us. Our announcements run as slides at the beginning of the service, and they can also be found in Wednesday's weekly e-news. If you don't receive the e-news, ask an usher to show you how to sign up. Our Community Plate member this month is the Minister's Discretionary Fund. Staff at UU Asheville attempt to identify congregants who might appreciate some financial support. Not easy, since they have no access to a member's financial status. We try to find you if you are in need. The ministers request two things. If you are suffering financial distress or are aware that one of your UU Asheville friends is experiencing financial hardship, please let Reverend Audette or Reverend Claudia know. This information is held in strict confidence. The rest of us can contribute to the minister's discretionary fund by writing Community Plate in the memo line of a check, and you can also donate online. For the gifts of your time, your treasure, your wisdom, and your attention, we are grateful.
Well, that wasn't as difficult as I thought it was going to be, so I'm glad. All right. Our closing words, and thank you for joining me this morning. This has been a great service, and it's great to see everyone. Our closing words this morning are from Ann Zucker Morgenstern. Teachers everywhere. In every person we meet, especially those who cause us discomfort, we find an opportunity for us to grow, to learn, to go further along the path of transformation that is our purpose in life. Every single one is our teacher. May the next week bring you many moments of meeting that help you become the person that you want to be. And may you welcome them with joy. Be well.
And we invite everyone to stay after we sing our closing song and sing with a video that's going to come up next. But for now, please rise in body or spirit as we sing our closing song, followed by the postlude. That's a time of fellowship in Sandburg Hall. If you need to leave during the postlude, please do so quietly so that everyone can enjoy the music.
Stay and sing
with us.
May the long time sun shine upon you.
Happy Sunday, 5 minutes to spare. Thank you. Thank you, I appreciate it. Oh, yay. I know, right? Bye, thank you. Yeah.